People go through stages, like where they're up and down, and like this is, you know, like a great time for kids like to encounter God.
Me and a group of friends, we just got together before Encounterfest and we started praying for it, that people's lives would be changed, not just for like a week or for a month at a time, but that their life would be fully changed and that the destination in their life would be completely different just because they went to that one evening. Well, it is not a human right to stay.
Yeah. it's really important to have things like EncounterFest where we really get into God and seek Him for ourselves, and then we go out and show God's light to others through that.
We have a responsibility to actually go out and show like what justice should be like.
When we praise God and we worship Him, we're just fully like letting ourselves go. We're saying to God, you know, just take over it and take over our lives, Lord. So like take control so we can go into the community and like we won't be afraid to stand up for you, and we won't be afraid to just talk to people about you.
Thank you. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 4, and we're going to jump right into this. My message tonight is called A Generation of Light. Turn to the person next to you and say, you look very bright tonight. There is a brightness exuding out of you that is amazing. Matthew chapter 4, verse 15. Matthew, who is writing this, is quoting from Isaiah, the prophet from many years before, and he writes here, quoting from Isaiah, Matthew 4, chapter 4, verse 15. He says, "The land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by way of the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And upon those who sat in the region in the shadow of death, light has dawned." Verse 17 says, "And from that time Jesus began to preach and to say, 'Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.'" Now, I want you to catch this. This is one of those moments. You know how the Bible has moments? This is one of those. This is a really significant moment, because right here, as Matthew is writing, Jesus is literally about to uncover the truth of who he is. Jesus right here is to begin his public ministry, kind of to switch the light on, if you like, to uncover the true light of who he is. This is an amazing moment. You see, right here, Matthew, as he quotes from Isaiah, is talking about the fact that there has been darkness all around the place. In fact, so much darkness that it's to the point of literally, as it says, like a shadow of death over the people. And yet Jesus is coming and bringing this light. Up until that point, Jesus is about 30 years of age at this point. Up until that point, he has been living as a good Jewish boy. He's been living in his Jewish family with his dad, who was a carpenter, learning his dad's trade. And he's been doing whatever his mom tells him to do, as every good Jewish boy does. And he's hanging out with his brothers. He had a number of brothers. Have you ever thought about what it would be like with Jesus as your brother? That would be tough. I think it would be tough. Some of you are going, "Oh man, that'd be awesome." No, I think it would be tough, because he never gets it wrong. He gets it right every time. I mean, he always cleans up after dinner. He always makes his bed. He always cleans his room. He always does the right thing. It would be kind of tough when your mum is saying, "Why can't you be like your brother Jesus?" Can you imagine being Jesus' brother and going out to play some games, playing hide and seek? He's always going to win. Any game, he's going to be the best. Baseball or something, bang, home run. He'd pitch at the ball, would be there before you even saw it. Let's go water skiing. He doesn't even need water skis. He's just out there. It would be tough. But here they are, and here Jesus has grown up. In fact, the Bible says this in Luke chapter 2, verse 52. It says about Jesus as he grew, that he grew in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and man. So literally, as Jesus grew up, he continued to grow. He grew in favor with God and in stature, but also with man. And I think that's the way it should be, that as you grow in your relationship with God, so also should you grow in relationship with other people. That as you grow in relationship with God, your stature should grow in your community, in your family, in your school, your university, wherever it is you're at. Things should grow in your life as things grow with God. It says of Jesus as he grew, to the point where here we see literally the uncovering of who Jesus is, the true light of the world. And if you read through Matthew chapter 4, it talks about how it begins, where Jesus is baptized by John the Baptist, and then he's led out into the wilderness where he confronts the devil. And I want you to think about that. Because right here we see Jesus, who is the true light, confronting the devil, who literally is the prince of darkness. And darkness confronts light. And the devil, his plan was always to attack the humanity of Jesus. And that's what people will always try and do, to bring Jesus down to just the level of any other human. The enemy tries to attack him and seduce him and do all sorts of things to bring him just down to being like any other human. And yet we know what is true is that Jesus each time spoke back to the enemy with the word of God. And as he spoke the word of God, there was nothing that the enemy, the devil, could do. And what I love about that is the truth is that no matter what darkness is around, when the light of light shows up in the house, the darkness has to go. It cannot stay. And I'm telling you, when Jesus showed up, it didn't matter what the devil had to say. There was nothing that darkness could do when the light began to show up. You see, Jesus is the true light. I don't know about you, but when I was growing up and when I was young, I was a little bit afraid of the dark. Is there anyone here who, when they were growing up, was just a little bit afraid? Maybe some of you still a little bit afraid of the dark. I was sharing my heart. I was a little bit afraid of the dark. I would lie, you know, sometimes you lie in bed. Why is it you're afraid of the dark? Because, you know, you can't quite see what's there. You know, imagination starts to run wild, and then fear starts to take hold. And to the point sometimes where I'd be lying in bed and I'd be afraid to put my hand down next to the bed because I thought something was underneath going to grab it. Some of you know what I'm talking about. It happened once. I had my brother under the bed. He was not a brother like Jesus. Something about the darkness fills us with fear at times. Causes our imagination to run wild, causes us to think about all the possibilities that ultimately become negative things, and this negative perspective we start to take on light on our life when the darkness starts to overwhelm us. And yet Jesus was this true light, and as he began to shine, he literally radically exposed the darkness, ultimately overcoming death and brilliantly illuminating the way to God. You see, what do you do when you're hidden and you're in the darkness and you're starting to freak out a little bit? You flick on the light, don't you? Or if you were like me, so you could sleep at night, you'd get a night light. Who remembers night lights? Some of you still have them. You don't have to admit it right now, but, you know, it's cool. I had a night light. You know, you could get night lights. They were all different kinds of animals. They were little puppy dogs. You know, the little pussy cats, I think I had Dumbo as a night light. It's big elephant ears would glow. I loved little Dumbo, the glowing in the dark elephant. He made everything okay. Because the darkness couldn't get where the light was. But let me ask you a question. Have you ever thought of the origin of where light came from? Because I think if we understand a little bit of that, then it can help us to understand the light and the power of it. You see, back in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 3, it says that God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. But you can actually read it the way it was written in the Hebrew. And if you read it the way it was written in the Hebrew, it would be something like this. God said, "Light be," and it was. God said, "Light be," and it was. You see, when God says something, it does not change. And from the time that man has been able to measure light, light speed has been a constant. And beyond that, as man has been able to check out the universe, the speed the universe is growing at is the speed of light. There is one constant. In fact, you and I can't see all that light is. We can only see a portion of what it is. You see, the amazing thing about light is that through you, beyond you, and around the universe, universe, light is the one constant, and it doesn't matter what darkness is about. The truth is that light will always overcome the darkness. God said it, and it's true. Come on, if God said it, then it's true. It's the truth today, and it will always be the truth. God said it, and it's true. You see, the place where light needs to shine is the dark places. Jesus came and shone in the darkness, and he messed up. All the darkness was about. He came into the dark places of people's lives. He came into the dark places where people were in despair. He came into the dark places where literally society had shunned people and put them down. And he brought this light there. In fact, he came and he brought light even to those who had wealth and maybe had position and maybe had power, and yet in their soul there was darkness. He brought light into those places. It didn't matter who they were or what their position was in society or what they were facing. Jesus brought light into all of those places. You see, but now I want you to read with me Matthew chapter 5 and verse 16. You see, Matthew chapter 4 talks about how Jesus is this light. But I want you to read with me what the next chapter says about Jesus and this light and what he says about it. Matthew chapter 5, verse 14, Jesus is speaking. How do we know it's Jesus? It's in red, that's right. You guys are so intelligent tonight. I knew it. Matthew chapter 5, verse 14, Jesus says, "You are the light of the world." Hang on a minute, Jesus, isn't that your job? Jesus here says, no, you are the light of the world. He goes on and says, a city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. But Jesus, I thought that was your job. And he says, yes, it is my job. But he says, it's also yours. And you might be looking at your life and thinking, yeah, but I don't know whether I can live like that. I kind of get consumed sometimes with things that aren't right. I don't know if I can really live. That's your job, Jesus. I'm just here just enjoying everything, but you're the light. And he says, no, you're the light, and you can live it out when you allow me inside of you. My light starts to shine out of your life, and the closer you get to me, the more brightly you start to shine. You see, Jesus wants to shine his light through you to bring change to some dark places in our world. You got to make a decision though. How am I going to live that out? You see, the question then is, where do you shine this light? I mean, do we just come to church and have a nice little time shining our lights and singing nice little songs like this little light of mine? I'm going to let it shine, this little light of mine. I'm going to let it shine, this little light of mine. I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, very beautiful. Give yourselves a round of applause. Fantastic. But is Jesus, is he just saying, well, yeah, you need to go to church and shine your light in there because that's where the light shines. That's the space, that's the place for the light to be. That's kind of where you should shine it. Well, as I think about this, I think about the fact that light is not really necessary where light already exists. Did you hear what I said? Then light is not always really very necessary in places where light already exists. It's good to come into the house of God, and we need to do that, and we need to be in church, and we need to gather together. But there is a world that is full of darkness, and that is the place where we need some people, come on, who are going to start to shine some light, not where there is light, but where there's darkness. It's time to see a generation of light start to rise up and start to shine in some dark places, not to hide it, not to cover it up, not to have a nice little lighting ceremony amongst all the others who have the light and look at the different shades of light and compare how that's a beautiful light. No, I like your light. Oh, look what we can do. We can turn the lights on. Isn't this glorious? No, it's not about that. It's not about hiding it. It's not about covering it up. It's not about having a nice little religious moment, but it is about shining forth the light into the hearts and minds of people who are in darkness. I want to read to you a letter that I received only about a month ago. And when I received it and I read it, I literally have kept it on my desk from the moment I received it, because I really didn't quite know what to do with it. It absolutely stirred me and reminded me of really what we're all about. And this is a letter from a young lady who I understand was at one of our United Worship Nights that we had in America about a month or so ago. She writes, "Pastor Phil, hello." She says, "Thank you for coming to Los Angeles in August. I was there in the overflow room. Thanks for playing a song in the overflow room. It was nice to actually see you all. The whole evening was a blessing and an encouragement to me, as well as confirming of God's unfailing love. It was a powerful evening. Thanks for the message." She goes on and says, "I really believe in what you're talking about, and I'm so hungry for God. I want to really know him." Says, "Pastor Phil, that night in Los Angeles, I felt a warmth in me that I couldn't explain when I lifted my hands during worship. I felt like my hands were on fire. I know it's God's presence with me, and I want to share with you something that I don't often speak about. Even though I know Christ lives in me, I struggle with dark thoughts. I feel suicidal, like I think I'm being attacked with thoughts in my head. You see, my mom took her own life a few years ago. And I feel like my mom's death was kind of my fault because I told her what my uncle had been doing to me and the pain that it had caused. I would have kept quiet if I knew all the pain that was ahead. I just did not want to go through that anymore. Because I spoke up, I don't see some members of my family. And I feel kind of on my own, and I miss my mom. I wish there were friends who'd been in my mom's life who could have shared Christ with her. That's why I have a lot of compassion for people who are hurting and don't know Christ. I want to cry with them and tell them about Jesus. I want them to be saved. I want them to be able to experience God's healing, and I want to bring it to other people. I want what the enemy had intended to be for evil to be used instead for the glory of God. I want the fatherless to know that they have a father. I desire to see people set free, and God is doing this in my life. And when United came, it was part of fanning that flame. I want the lost to know they're being looked for and found by a God who died for them so long ago, a God who is living and active. I want to be part of the righteous here on the earth. I want to pray God's will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I want to stand united with other Christians. I'm hungry for God. Been trying to memorize scriptures, and I've been memorizing Psalm 34. My favorite part says, "I cried out to the Lord, and in my suffering he heard me and he set me free of all my fears." I guess it's easy to write because, you know, you're far away and all the rest of it. She says, I'm just a normal girl who likes to smile, likes to dance, likes to jump around and make friends. Most of all, love Jesus with all my heart. I'm hungry for God. And then she goes on and says, "I'm sending you an offering for more tours and outreaches that will bring Christ to a world that desperately needs him, like I need him. I want to stand along with you. And then she put $25 in a letter. I think that's pretty powerful. You see, there is a very dark world that we live in. There are all sorts of things going on in the hearts and lives of people. Some of them are going on in nations that people are living in poverty and with disease. Other of them are living in our own suburbs and experiencing all kinds of darkness. I have here a candle. The question is, if your life were this candle, what darkness will you shine your light into? You see, a candle is often lit in churches as a symbol of hope, a symbol that their prayer is being offered for someone. It's a symbol of hope that the light shines and that light can bring hope to people in desperate and in dark places. You see, there is a generation today that really is out and is asking a question: does anyone care anymore? Is there any hope? We have songs on the radio right now that are singing, hey, I wish I'd been born in the 60s and 70s, revolution was in the air, I was born too late to a world that doesn't care. And we have a generation that is asking the question, does anyone care? A generation that is asking, will darkness and evil prevail? Will violence and terrorism win out and destroy our society? Will AIDS and disease spread and take over? Will homelessness and hunger and poverty wipe out generations? Will racism increase? Will emotional heartache from broken lives and families take our self-esteem and our confidence? Will drugs and addictions destroy our future? Will the rich get richer and poor get more desperate? Is this all there is? Is this all that life has become? Has darkness won? Is this all that there is? There are people asking that question, but I am here to tell you, even in a world that in many instances doesn't look like there's much hope, even for a young girl who writes a letter and says, hey, there's been some darkness inside of me. I love what my Bible says. I love what the Word of God says, because in Micah chapter 7 and verse 8, it says, do not rejoice over me, my enemy. When I fall, I will arise. When I sit in darkness, the Lord will be a light to me. The good news is that light is never, ever intimidated by the darkness, and it does not matter how dark things get. When some people shine a light, come on, when some people start to shine a light, then the darkness has to flee. It has to go. And the more he'll shine that light, the brighter our world will be. And the question tonight is, will you choose to be one who shines your light? Will you choose not to be intimidated? Will you choose to love when others are dealing in hate? Will you choose to be generous when others are dealing in greed? Will you choose to give when others are dealing in selfishness? Will you choose to be one who says, I will uncover the light of Jesus Christ inside of me, and I won't be intimidated, and I will stand, and I will choose to be one of those who's experienced the love of God, and that truth that is alive in my heart, I cannot and I will not hide it away. There is a light that shines in dark places. Yeah. And that light announces there is hope. Sin can and is forgiven through Jesus Christ. Prayers will be answered. Broken lives can be restored. The sick can be healed. Oppression can be lifted. Injustice can be quenched. The poor can be helped. And freedom can reign in the hearts of anyone who calls on the name of Jesus. Come on. We got to live that kind of life. We got to be people who shine that light. Jesus can bring freedom to those, whoever they are, who are in desperate places. But God is looking for a people, a generation, who will choose to shine His light. I'd like the team to come up. We have a song that we're going to sing. And as we do that, we have some young people who are going to bring some lights. You see, one light can make a difference, but if all of us choose to live that kind of life, imagine the impact our lives could be. And as the guys sing this song, I just want to read to you from Philippians chapter 2, verse 14. And 15. It says, do all these things without complaining and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless, children of God, without fault, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. We are called to shine as lights in this world.